Greetings, brothers and sisters. I'm Professor Spira, and welcome back to our discussion about fasting. I'll be reading some excerpts from Professor Arnold Ehret's Mucus-free Diet Healing System, annotated, revised, and edited by Professor Spira. But some of this material also can be found in Rational Fasting for Physical, Mental, and Spiritual Rejuvenation. How to break a fast. The right food after a fast is as important and decisive for proper results as the fast itself. At the same time, it depends entirely upon the conditions of the patient and very much upon the length of the fast. You may learn from the results of the two extreme cases, both of which ended fatally, not from the fast, but from the first wrong meal, just why this knowledge is so important. A one-sided meat eater suffering from diabetes broke his fast with which lasted about a week by eating dates and died from the effects. A man of over 60 years of age fasted 28 days, which was too long. His first meal of vegetarian foods consisting mainly of boiled potatoes. A necessary operation showed that the potatoes were kept in the contracted intestines by thick, sticky mucus so strong that a piece had to be cut off and the patient died shortly after the operation. So, as Eric says, you know, breaking a fast is so important. Breaking the fast properly. Like I like to say, a fast is as only effective as how well you broke it. So this discussion is a very important discussion. In these two cases, case studies that he does here, he talks about first someone that suffering from diabetes broke this week-long fast with dates. Now, if you're having sugar metabolism issues, you know, dates are not even something you probably really want to mess with like that in the first place, and definitely not something that you want to use to break a fast. Yet I still hear people wanting, you know, breaking fast with dried fruit in that kind of way, where they're, you know, things like dates and that kind of stuff. And it's like, no, that is not, when you're doing a fast for detoxification purposes, dates are not the route. You know, I would not recommend using dates as something to break your fast with. Then in the other case, we have someone that tried to, you know, fast for 28 days, and then for whatever reason, it could have been that they just lost control, and went back to the foods that they were kind of used to. You know, maybe they were used to vegetarian type of foods, and so they fasted that length of time. Maybe felt fine for a long period of time, but got to that 28th day and boiled up some potatoes and ate that, and the slime in his intestines that had been brought to the surface was so sticky, like rubber cement or something, or like super glue, gorilla glue inside the body, that when it came into contact with this this potato, it got stuck, you know, just totally stuck to the walls of the intestines with this super glue that was released over those 28 days of fasting. You know, that's some serious stuff. And we have to respect, you know, there's a reason why Eric recommends, as we get into it, the lemon juice, fasting in the section called fasting drinks, which we have not yet got to in these discussions. There's a reason why lemon juice and lemonade, you know, the honey lemonade, if you're a hardcore vegan, you can use other things besides honey, but the lemonade approach, because you start to neutralize that sticky super glue that is potentially in, for most people, inside their body, inside the GI tract. And that's the genius of the of when you think in terms of long-term mucus's diet and transition, you are able to slowly neutralize and slowly start to the process of transforming your physiology, not overnight, not in a short little period of time, but over time so that it's safe. And so by the time you get to the point where you are able to do a longer fast, or you feel compelled to do a longer fast like this, you not only won't you feel the need to break it suddenly with something that's dangerous, you will be able to control that part, you know, much better. It's not always perfect. I mean, sometimes it's messy. And I'll say that right now. So it's you. There's gonna be, you know, I speak from experience. One of the reasons why I talk about the importance of transitioning into and out of fast is because I experienced early on a few times not doing real great at that. The key is you don't want to get it do so bad that it's like in this, and that's why we say 2 to 3 day fast. You know, that Ehret recommends in here, as opposed to starting off with these long fasts where you're setting yourself up to potentially lose control. So what if you are able to do a long fast and you don't lose control the first time? Great. You know, I guess pat you on the back, but don't have unrealistic expectations about the next time. The next time might, you know, if that fast might have your number. And you don't want to, you always got to keep that in mind. You got to really respect the fasting process. You know, this isn't playing games, and this isn't just all, you know, fun and happy-go-lucky, you know, SpongeBob SquarePants type of vibe. I mean, this is real work and real business and real healing, and it should be respected. And sometimes I don't see that. I don't see the respect for fasting that there should be. I see haphazardness and people and egos and people wanting to prove something to somebody and or seeing that somebody else did a fast, so I got to fast like them and I got to do that. This has nothing to do with nobody else except you. It's all about you. This is your body. This is your healing journey. It's your physiological past and present that you're dealing with that will ultimately create your physiological future. So this don't have nothing to do with me, Brother Ehret, Takora, anybody else. The mechanics are the mechanics. And that's what we're trying to cover here, is the mechanics of fasting. But these mechanics can be applied on a smaller level or a larger level. Meaning you can apply the same principles of a 24-hour fast, of getting into and out of a 24-hour fast, to getting into and out of a year-long fast. I'm not promoting that. I'm just saying, logically, multiplication, if you can think like that, you can think in terms of evolutional processes that unfold over time, that evolve, that change for the better, then you can understand what, you know, my point, what I'm trying to say there. In the first case, the terrible poisons loosened in the stomach of the one-sided meat eater during his fast, when mixed with the concentrated fruit sugar of the dates, caused at once so great a fermentation with carbonic acid gases and other poisons that the patient could not stand the shock. The correct advice would be, first, a laxative, later raw and cooked starchless vegetables, a piece of rough bran bread toast. Sauerkraut is to be recommended in such cases. No fruit should be eaten for a long time after the fast has been broken. The patient should have been prepared for for the fast by a longer transition. So right again, packs so much into one paragraph of just knowledge and information that's vital to understand if you're going to be a successful faster and potentially in the future help somebody else fast. So one-sided meat eater. So when I'm dealing with someone that was a uric acid type or one-sided meat eater, I'm already thinking more conservatively. But the thing is, for some reason, a lot of people that start off as uric acid type of physiologies and personalities that sometimes come along with that are to go full bore and like forget all that transition crap. Like, I'm gonna do that first. And that's what this guy did. See, there's something to learn there. And that's a study I would love. I mean, those are more advanced studies. I know some of y'all want that kind of analysis, but there's something to be said for personality types that go along with different physiologies. And it's hard because there's a, you know, it's hard to do more than sort of just a general observation and anecdotal kind of thing, but there's something to it. And we see a lot, there's a certain type of personality. I don't see a whole lot of mucus types have this, have a certain kind of thing that I'm seeing in a lot of uric acid types. And what it is a lot of mucus types I notice, they tend to be more cautious. They seem like they're a little more cautious and conservative in terms of their transition. Like they ain't trying to rush nowhere. It's like, look, I'm gonna just deal with this. Whereas I've just seen a lot of uric acid type folks that, I mean, it's like they're diving into a pool with 1 foot of water in it, and ain't even putting their hands out in front of them. They're diving in head first, like it's on, you know. So I'm saying that not to criticize anybody or anything like that. It's this that we have to be aware of what we're bringing to the mucus's diet. What personality characteristics are we bringing to the mucus's diet healing system, and how is that going to affect our practice? If we know that we have a tendency to take things to the extreme, then from the get-go, pull back. If you know you got, if you got a more extreme personality, if you're the type of person that's just like, you know, that's looking around for the next thing, that's like, what, you know, get me, you know, challenge me. You know, you looking around for the next challenge, like what? Then with this mucusless diet, I'm warning you. And I'm saying, take it easy. This ain't what you think it is. Because this will take a person that thinks they're the most hardcore person on the planet and will reduce you down to, you know, a little child cowering in the corner, sucking their thumb. That's how deep this can get. It depends on you. And I'm not saying that happened to everybody, but I'm saying what I've noticed from some people that try to take these things to the extreme, and they try to do the all fruit diet for a long time, and they feel great for a while. You know, I work with a lot of people that come from Dr. Morris. He's able to help a lot of people, and a lot of people, you know, using his methodology are cool. But there's a number of people that they don't get the transition methodology. They don't go through short-term fasting periods because he doesn't teach that and promote that. And so I work with a lot of people that have not been able to, you know, either hang with that type of all fruit regimen for a long period of time, or they, I mean, I've a number of people, just like these case studies I've talked to, they've done 40-day, 50-day fruit periods, or even liquid fasting, and then they had a relapse, a mucus relapse, And out of nowhere, they went all the way back to eating meat, eating, you know, drinking milk and ice cream and all that kind of stuff. And that's a serious relapse. Wouldn't it be safer if one of those, because I'm not criticizing the relapse, I'm criticizing and critiquing fasting that long and then having the ability to have such a relapse. So you shouldn't fast for a long period of time until you know that it's impossible for you to relapse on certain foods and where you wouldn't have that control. So for me, at this point in my transition, and it's been like this for a long time, I know that it would be impossible for me to relapse on meat and dairy. It's not going to happen. The desire for it has left me for years. So if I get into a longer fast and I start craving something or I lose control, I'm only going to, you know, I would only lose control to a certain extent. I'm not going all the way back. But story after story of folks that have been dealing with Dr. Morris and other people, whether, you know, there's these some of these fasting clinics and I work with a lot of them people, you know, that have whether it's medical doctors that are observing a fast or if it's other kinds of people. I've worked with a number of those folks where those were people that didn't need to fast that long or they weren't ready. They didn't transition into it. And then a lot of these instances, we're talking more about water fasting anyway. So that's already getting away from Eric's recommendations of the lemonade or the fruit juice fasting. So all that, this paragraph is like so much there. It kind of just inspired me to just go off on all these different directions. But it's just so important. You know, it's just so important to understand that this is not a race. It's not a competition. And this is not a shortcut, because I think that's the other reason why some people want to try to do these long fasts immediately up front. They want a shortcut. They would say, well, if I do this, then I can just heal, right? You know, I'm just not messing around. I'm healed. But again, you're missing out on the transition. You're missing out on the safety that comes from slowly cleaning yourself. And when I say slow, I'm not talking about a snail's pace, in terms of where you're not doing anything to advance yourself toward a mucus-free lifestyle. So that's what makes this an art form is nuances. And there's some people of the opinion that you go slower than slow, that you don't eat any fruit for a long time, and you don't try to mess with fasting for a real long time, and certain transitional items you would use for a long period of time. Then there's the other extreme of people that say, you don't need to transition. Just eat number fruit now, fruit, berries, and love, and just, you know, fast, and you don't need any kind of preparation, anything. Both of these approaches don't line up, in my opinion, with at least with Eric's recommendations. And the reason I always go back to Eric's recommendations is because it gives us a foundation. It gives us a jumping off point from where to have a discussion. So it's not to say that you know, everybody, you have to, it's all about Eric. It's like, no, this gives us a common point of reference, a relationship. We relate to one another based on Eric's work. You know, a community relationship based on, it has to be based on something if you're going to have a community, or it's just a bunch of people kind of with roughly similar interests that, you know, that's, and it don't really work. There's been people I've worked with that were unable to eat fruit at all, you know, physiologically speaking. They couldn't handle fruit for various reasons. And so they can still use this information and transitional technology to make progress, even if it's small amounts of progress. You know, those are complicated cases sometimes, but the principle of the evolutional change, whether it be in the fasting realm or it's the eating realm or it's any other realm, you know, there's something to that that's very important to understand. If you're, you know, from in the art realm, in studies in school, do you start off learning advanced calculus and learning about, you know, Plato and Aristotle and Pythagoras? I mean, do you in kindergarten, do you start there, or where do you start? You know, An Apple, that was a book that we read, that there was a series called An Apple, and we was learning how to read. You know, so you first grade, you know, you learning how to read. Second grade, you can read, you know, you learning your addition and subtraction and your times tables, and you starting to get to a point you can read a little bit bigger books. Third grade, now you're starting to read those little kind of small novels, and you know, at least in our school system, that's everybody's little. Again, even with that, there's different speeds. The school system makes it tough because there's some people that can go a little faster and they can maybe read better at a younger age. And then there's some people like me, like it took me a while to learn how to read. And the school system made me feel like I was stupid or had something like a learning disability or something, because I was unable to learn how to read as fast as other people that was around me. And so I understand that this competition type of person, you know, just personality, I mean, there are those personalities, but that type competition type of vibration is embedded in many of us depending upon just our upbringing and our schooling. So I understand, so that's where I think some of that comes from, where people have this obsession with doing and trying to do more than or better than or living up to what other people did. And that's not what fasting is about. It's not about, oh, Brother Ehret did 9-month fast, so I need to do 9-month fast. You observed the wrong thing. What did he do for 35 years that got him to a point where he was able to do a long fast like that? If that kind of fasting is something that is interesting to you. So that competition thing that they foster, because I mean, we have reading groups and all, you know, if you weren't in this top reading group, then you weren't given the same preferential treatment as the other kids and stuff. You know, math groups, all this kind of stuff, it kind of fostered this environment of competition. And we have to learn how to let that go. For those of us that grew up in that kind of environment, you can't bring that to the Mucus-free Diet Healing System. This is not about competition against your peers. You know, this is about you getting as deep as you can into your own personal physiology and going on your path. So, it's a couple more little. Let me read these last couple paragraphs here since we're almost done. In the second case, the patient fasted entirely too long for a person of his age without proper preparation. Hot compresses on the abdomen and high enemas might have helped the elimination, together with a strong eliminative, laxative, and then starchless, mostly raw vegetables, no fruit for a considerable period of time. Here, again, he's talking about somebody that did not prepare properly. There has been people that have come to me from Dr. Morris or come to me from some of these other water fasting clinics that I use. That's what I recommended for them. This was the methodology, as Ehret says, to help people from having fasted too long without the proper preparation. That's what he's explaining here. So this is not a general recommendation for everybody to say, oh, well, no, well, don't eat fruit. If you take that from this, then you're wrong, in my opinion, and obvious from the context of this whole section, where this is after somebody has fasted for too long and is, you know, elimination is too heightened. Eating these mucus-free vegetables, doing the enemas, getting the laxatives going, or the movers, as I like to say, that is, you know, and they talk about the high, the compresses, all of that, getting the circulation, getting things to loosen up, because the person tried to fast too long and too hard for their physiology without the proper preparation. So that's what that methodology is about. Just that little paragraph I just read right there is, if somebody comes to you in that kind of situation, that's along the lines that you want to think. You want to think along those lines of, okay, this is how you cut the fruit out, stop the fruit eating, and let's deal with this. Then maybe to transition back into fruit, again, transition diet. You, instead of going into the raw fruit, you get into the cooked fruit and the baked and the stewed fruits. Through these two very instructive examples, you may see how individually different the advice must be and how wrong it is to make up general suggestions concerning how to break a fast. This is what I was looking for, a mic. Peace, love, and breath.